We should do a new camera.
Alright, we'll get started. Did everyone have a good weekend? Did you turn mostly over?
No.
No. So, love our studies.
Starting now.
Okay. So where we left off yesterday was talking about, was talking about dissolved oxygen and some of the limitations you have with dissolved oxygen. So let's just see if anyone was paying attention. So is there a relationship between dissolved oxygen and cell growth rate if you're above a certain minimum? So if you've got a minimum amount of dissolved oxygen, will adding more change your growth rate? No. So after you get to that saturation point, well, but not the saturation point, but the point where there's enough oxygen, then it no longer becomes a limiting nutrient. Where you have to be worried is where it is a limiting nutrient. So there's a little bit of very, very simple modeling you can do and understand how oxygen gets transferred and some of the limitations to oxygen transfer. So how do we get oxygen to, like, say we're growing a bunch of E. coli in a bioreactor. E. coli is metabolically active, it grows way faster, if it has oxygen. How do you get that oxygen to the E. coli?
Sparging.
So what does that mean?
Bubbling oxygen after the reactor.
Okay, so you're putting lots of little bubbles that have actually usually air, not pure oxygen in them. Up through the reactor, and your E. coli or somewhere over here, floating around in your reactor. Okay, so you've got your E. coli floating around in your reactor, and they're seeing some oxygen concentration Cl. Okay, what would be the oxygen concentration right at the outside of the bubble? Right where the air meets water. Just a little bit into the water would be oxygen concentration. You can give me a number, you can tell me how you would figure it out. What do you think? How would you figure out what the oxygen concentration is immediately next to your bubble? You guys took thermo. Figure out solubilities, right? Would it be, what do you think? How could you figure it out? Probably use Henry's law. But does that sound at all familiar? But would it be saturated right by the bubble?
Most likely.
Yeah, because it's immediately next to an oxygen source. There's been nothing to take it away. So immediately next to the bubble you have your saturated oxygen concentration. So if you want to try and understand how fast the oxygen can get out of the bubbles and into the medium, then you need to know a little bit about what's going on. So overall, the rate at which the oxygen transfers, say you have a big bioreactor and you want to know your total rate of oxygen transfer to the big bioreactor, what are things that would change that total rate of oxygen concentration? Or oxygen transfer to the medium. So we know that this is C star, right? That's our saturated oxygen concentration. That's not gonna change unless it's not gonna change unless we dramatically change the conditions in the reactor. Actually, the only way to, how would you get it to go up in the reactor? Lower the temperature, exactly. So if you heat it up, then you actually have a lower saturation oxygen concentration. So you have two things going on. You you know, you move it from 25 to 37 and your cells start growing faster and there's less oxygen available to them. Okay, so C star, given the conditions, is constant. How could you, and you're starting with a certain reactor setup with certain sparging, how could you improve or increase the amount of oxygen that transfers into the medium? What are things you can do?
Increase the oxygen.
Like in the bubble?
Oh, wait, no.
So you still, you're probably still, even if you have 100% of oxygen in here, you're probably still just saturating the water with the oxygen. So how would you increase the oxygen? What are ways that you could overall in the whole thing?
Mixing?
Yeah. So what does mixing do as far as mass transfer goes?
Increases the mass transfer coefficient?
Yeah. So our mass transfer coefficient, we're going to call KL, right? So that's your driving force for oxygen transfer? What's making it transfer? Yeah.
The concentration gradient?
Yeah, so C star minus Cl, right? Okay, so that's our oxygen transfer coefficient. So basically, that goes down because our boundary layer is going down if you have more mixing, right? Now, we're not saying any more per bubble, so what's the other thing you can do to increase your total amount of oxygen transfer? So you bubble a certain amount in, you can mix it faster, and that'll increase your oxygen transfer because you decrease or increase your KL. What else could you do? Would you see a difference in oxygen transfer if I let go one big bubble every 5 seconds? Or if I used even the same amount of air and let it go in tiny little bubbles over the same amount of time, which one do you think would have better oxygen transfer? Someone say it.
Tiny little bubbles,
thank you. So why would tiny little bubbles, so we've now got the same amount of oxygen going through our reactor, why would tiny little bubbles have a better oxygen transfer rate than one big bubble every 5 seconds?
Higher surface area?
Yeah, exactly. So what we've got there is area of the bubbles. And we're going to call that oxygen transfer rate. So this is, and this is actually gas, liquid, interfacial area. So it's centimeters square per volume. So basically, how much surface area do you have in a given volume? And of course, if you have one big bubble, you're going to have a lot less surface area in that volume than if you have lots and lots of little bubbles. Right? That makes sense, right? Okay. Our KL is in centimeters per hour. Our oxygen transfer rate is in milligrams O2 per liter per hour. Okay, so it's actually not uncommon to be given actually just KL. for a given condition, and that's the volumetric oxygen transfer coefficient. In inverse hours. Okay, obviously you can change KLA by doing lots, by changing your mixing, by changing your sparging rate, by changing the design of the sparger so you get different size bubbles. So all of those things have the possibility of changing KLA. But in this course, we're not going to try and calculate KLA. You learn how to do stuff like that in your mass transfer courses. It's a separate thing. But be aware that a big part of bioreactor design is designing it so that things like your KLA are optimized. I will say, most of the time, unless you work for a bioreactor company, you're going to buy something pretty much off the shelf. So you can change, you can play with your parameters, you can play with how fast the oxygen and the air is going through, you can play with your mixing rate, and that'll have the ultimate effect of changing your oxygen transfer rate. But you're probably not, unless you work for a bioreactor design company, you're probably not going to be playing much with changing that by changing the bioreactor design. Having said that, there are lots of people who, that's their job, like their research is designing better bioreactors and in new systems and new ways. Okay, so that's how fast, just from a purely mass transfer standpoint, that's how fast the oxygen transfer rate. It's also just called N, big N, and then little O2, subscript O2, is another thing that the oxygen transfer rate is called, so that you know the how it's done. Okay, that makes sense so far? Good. Now, the other side of the equation, why is CL lower than C star? Why doesn't it stay saturated through the solution? So another easy answer. Just throw it out there. Kirsten, what do you think? Why is CL lower than C star?
Because it would diffuse into your solution.
Pardon me?
Like it would diffuse into your solution?
Yes. It diffuses into your solution, but if you're looking at mass balance, what goes in must come out or get used up somehow. So if it's just a sterile solution, then you're managing to saturate it, unless it's going somewhere. Where would it be going? Where is all this oxygen going? Otherwise you just have a saturated solution all the time. Could bubble it through for a very limited period of time and you get it saturated and you seal it tight like a can of Coke and it stays saturated. So where's all this oxygen going?
To the cells.
Yeah. Thanks, Ryan. So the cells are using up the oxygen. So the other side of it is that you've got an oxygen uptake rate by the cells. Okay, and we're going to define that oxygen uptake rate by, so that's your total oxygen uptake rate, okay? We're going to define it as QO2, which is our specific O2 consumption rate. So specific always means that that's on a per cell basis, so each cell is using this much oxygen. But if we want to know our total oxygen uptake rate, then we just multiply it by the cell concentration, right? Good. Okay. So that's sort of the definition. But now we want to know how fast the cells, this is just not very useful. How fast are the cells actually using it? You want to be able to relate that to the growth rate of the cells. Okay. So the way we do that is this oxygen, how would you relate, we did this maybe two classes ago, how would you relate oxygen uptake rate to growth rate? is just yield of cells over O2. Right, so how much cells do you get for a given amount of O2? Or, in other words, how much O2 do you need for a given amount of cells? Right, so now the growth rate gets very simply related to the oxygen uptake rate. The specific growth rate gets related to the specific oxygen uptake rate just by that simple yield coefficient. How many cells do you get per given amount of oxygen? Okay, and then we multiply by x. Okay, does that make sense to everyone? Like pretty straightforward. We're just using now our yield coefficients in a slightly different way. Okay, so now we've got an oxygen transfer rate of a given amount and an oxygen uptake rate of a given amount. We're going to assume that we're not in that part where we've got way more oxygen than we possibly need. We're going to assume that we're in a regime where we're actually, our growth rate is oxygen limited. Okay, so if we're in a regime where our growth rate is oxygen limited, if you've got oxygen coming in one way, and the reason that it's lower here is that it's getting consumed, if we're at steady state, what can we say? How do our oxygen uptake rates and our oxygen transfer rates relate to one another at steady state?
Yeah.
I can really, if you guys are just as out of it as I am today, you can tell it's that time of term, right? Okay, so at steady state, oxygen uptake rate has to equal oxygen transfer rate, right? Because where else are the cells going to go? Or where else is the oxygen going to go? Unless your bioreactor is such that, you know, you've got vast amounts exposed to, I don't know, nitrogen or something, so it's off-gassing into your nitrogen atmosphere. It's all negatively. Okay. So if that's the case, we can do a simple balance. Sort of continuous reactor with air, oxygen being sparged into it. The growth rate that's happening there is determined by the physical conditions that determine KLA, so how big your bubbles are, how well it's mixed, what the saturation concentration is of your oxygen, and how many cells you get for a given amount of oxygen. Make sense? Awesome. Any questions about any of the dissolved oxygen stuff? Substrate concentration. So if you put in way more of your substrate than the cells are happy with, it can actually more or less poison the cells. You know, if you, there's a LD50 for salt and sugar, and those are, well, sugar at least is something that gives us energy, but it can also kill us if we have too much of it, just because of osmotic pressures, if nothing else. So most substrates actually have a maximum concentration above which they become inhibitory to cell growth. And it may just be an osmotic thing, it may be a biochemical thing. So just to give you some examples, maximum non-inhibitory concentrations, glucose, 100 grams per liter. So I actually, in the example that you were given where you had to figure out yield coefficients and how much cells you would then get if you put in more glucose, was actually a little bit of a trick question, because we didn't tell you that if you went above the 100 grams per liter that the initial question said, you're actually going to slow down the cells. Having said that, if you don't kill the cells, it just means that yield coefficients are not time-related. They're just like thermodynamics. They tell you what happens at the end of the day. So as long as you're not getting to the toxic substrate concentrations, if you go above those inhibitory concentrations, all it means is you're going to have a long period of really slow growth until it finally drops the substrate concentration below the inhibitory concentration. So you would eventually still get that higher yield. It would just take you forever to get there. So you don't really want that. Other ones, so ethanol, we think of as a product, but it actually is a carbohydrate. So it can be, I mean, there's a reason that you get a beer gut if you drink too much. It still is a substrate for growth. So cells can use ethanol as an energy source, but it's relatively low compared to glucose. For yeast, 50 grams per liter. So that's actually pretty high. So you can actually ferment stuff to it, depending on the yeast, to a pretty high concentration of ethanol, okay? But yeast has been evolved, well, yeast is good at it, and it's evolved to deal with pretty high concentrations of ethanol. So that's for yeast. But if you do that to your E. coli, or you do it to, because yeast has it as a byproduct, it's used to having some around, or you do it to mammalian cells, they're going to be much less happy with you. So, yeah, because that's for yeast. Way, way, way lower for other cells. What else? Ammonium. You wouldn't really expect that would be a happy substrate. It's in your pee. Phosphate. Something to keep in mind if you're trying to optimize your medium and you're looking at various additives, don't go above those things. It'll be problematic. Another thing that is very hard to measure or control, but is another thing that can actually affect the cells growing is redox potential. So it does depends on dissolved oxygen, pH, if there are other ions in your medium. But it also can affect your growth rates. We talked before a little bit about dissolved carbon dioxide. Generally you want some, most cells want some minimum amount of dissolved carbon dioxide for ideal function, but you can get to toxic amounts as well. So again, it's another troubleshooting thing. If your cell, if your cultures aren't growing properly, it could be the redox conditions, it could be the dissolved CO2, it could be inhibitory substrates. You could have other inhibitors that we'll talk about next class as well. Okay. Generally happy with some of the things that can affect your cell growth. Any other questions about that? Okay. So the other thing that can happen, we talked about the effect of temperature and how if you raise the temperature to a certain amount, the cells will grow more quickly, and if you go past a optimum amount, then they'll start to not perform and then eventually die. But that temperature actually in a closed system can change pretty rapidly if you have rapidly metabolizing cells. So how many people have ever composted? So you like put your leaves in a big pile and put some of your food waste in there, especially if you put lots of high nitrogen content. So if you just put your leaves, it's mostly carbon content, but if you put lots of yummy nitrogen in there that the bacteria like eating, what can happen in the middle of your compost pile? Is it the same temperature as the outside?
No, it's a bit warmer.
Yeah, in fact, if you don't turn it and deal with it and you have a very active compost heap, you can actually get ash in the middle of it because it can heat up so much that it then burns up the microorganisms that are making the heat. So in these closed systems, it's actually very possible for so much heat to be evolved from the microorganisms that they push themselves past that happy optimum temperature. You'd think it would be a little bit self-regulating, you know, you go too far past it, they stop growing and then they stop metabolizing and they stop making heat. But you don't really want your system getting to that point where they start making ash because they got too hot. You want a system where you're still keeping it at your happy growing temperature. And so to do that, you have to recognize, you have to set up your system so that it can usually, so that it can take heat away to keep it at the temperature you want. Any idea how you do that? How do you take heat away from a bioreactor? Yeah, so the smaller bioreactors, you typically have a water cooling jacket. You run water through the outside, and that's, you've got lots of stirring going on the inside, and that cools it down. You may need to do some more elaborate systems with large bioreactors, but if you've ever been, so this is actually an issue in breweries. If you've ever been to a brewery, you see all these really, especially the big ones, like pretty sizable tanks that you wouldn't think have all that awesome heat transfer, and they're still just cooled by a very large dimply metal cooling jacket on the outside that instead of water running through it, it has coolant running through it, but it's still just a basic cooling jacket. So there are probably, well, I know that there are better ways of doing it, but still most places that's what they do is, because it's the problem with more elaborate ways of doing it. Well, what would be a problem with a more elaborate way of doing it? Like say you put coils or a fancy radiator type thing inside your bioreactor, what would be the problem with that? Cooling coils in it or?
Sterilization problems.
Exactly. So the more little fidgety things you have with corners and undersides, the harder it is to make sure that your whole bioreactor gets properly sterilized. What we do, any ideas, how do you sterilize, how are you going to sterilize your bioreactor in 4LL3? You've got, there's a 1 liter one and a 3 liter one. How do those get sterilized? So that nothing else grows up between your organs and the intestines.
Autoclave?
Yeah, we have a big autoclave and you put your medium in it and you seal everything up with tin foil and you put it in the autoclave and heat it up for a good long time and you let it slowly cool back down. And that kills 99.999% of the organisms. So that's relatively easy. But if you have a Labatt-sized plant, I can't even imagine this. I mean, your autoclave would have to be bigger than this. I wouldn't say the whole building, but like this room, but 3 floors down. And it would be incredibly difficult to, you know, shimmy your very large tank over to an autoclave, along with all the fittings and everything like that, and then move it back out. Or even just heating a tank like that for the time that would be necessary would be incredibly expensive and just very, very difficult to do. So how do they do it with large bioreactors industrially? I know Emily actually knows, but I'm not sure she remembers. Yeah, you just spray caustic through it all, which is pretty nasty and kills everything. But you have to be, you don't want to leave that caustic behind to continue killing everything and making your beer taste awful. You need to then give it a rinse with sterile water, which is expensive, but it's less expensive than other methods of doing sterilization. But if you're spraying everything with caustic, then you have to be very, very careful about corners and nooks and crannies because they may not get properly sprayed with caustic. Just as like in the Schneider's plant, or the maple leaf plant, I mean, remember, does anyone, I don't know, it's a while ago now. Anyone remember what happened to the maple leaf plant? If you don't, that's good for maple leaf. How many people do remember what happened to the maple leaf plant? I forget how many years ago it was now.
5 years or something.
I think it might even be more than that. So what happened?
I don't remember all the details, but the Listeria outbreak has some sanitary conditions.
Yeah, so in the maple leaf plant, they made sliced meats, pre-sliced deli meats, and they had this. Listeria is hard to detect and hard to culture, so it's hard to know if you have it when you do after the fact testing. But it's still quite nasty to people. So they had this cleaning regime where they cleaned everything that they could see. It's kind of like my son brushing his teeth. He tells me 30 seconds after he starts that he's done. They managed to disassemble most things and sterilize them, but some of the really nooks and crannies in the depths of the meat slicer never got sterile. And so it ended up being a really nice culture location for Listeria. And the same thing actually happens in a lot of hospital-related infections. They've had to learn a lot of lessons about the things that can and can't be sterilized in medical equipment, because you have this really fancy, expensive medical equipment, and some of it is not so easy to sterilize in between every patient, and can be a source of hospital-based infections going between people. So you just have to be really aware and cautious about sterilizing things. Okay, but back to heat. So, when you have glucose and it's broken down, some of it goes into chemical energy, but about half of it goes into heat energy. You think that, you know, we're pretty efficient at transferring our carbohydrate sources because we have nice enzymes and everything and not losing a lot of that energy. Well, we're better than power plants, but we still are little generators. And so if we've got our cells, I mean, some people are more heat generators than others. And some cells are more heat generators than others. But you've got the cells, and you actually see a lot of the heat being most generated by actively growing cells, because they're doing a lot more like ATP generation and all that sort of thing to in order to actively grow. If you're just sitting there and maintaining, then your metabolism rate is relatively low. Okay, so the maintenance heat that happens is pretty low compared to the growth heat that happens. So it's generally neglected. Generally, you say almost all of the heat is just because cells are growing. Okay, so the way we can actually figure it out is by burning everything up. You burn up the donut, find out how many calories are in it. You burn up your substrate and you burn up your cells. And those heats of combustion and the differences in those heats of combustion can tell you something about how much heat is actually evolved by the cells. Okay, so you've got a heat of combustion of substrate, but now remember that not all the substrate goes in the cells, so we want to use our conversion factor to say how much of that heat of combustion of substrate is associated with each cell. Okay, and that's just our yield factor. Okay. And then equals our heat of combustion of cells. So that's actually what you care about. That's the amount of, that'll start telling you how much heat is actually, so if you burn up your cells or burn up your substrate, now you have a way of starting to figure out how much heat your cells are going to make from a given substrate. So you can imagine too that different substrates, if you feed your cells different substrates, they're going to make different amounts of heat. The other way of thinking about it is like glucose will make your fires burn really hot. You'll get a lot of heat coming off a substrate that can easily be converted to energy, whereas like more complex carbohydrates, you're probably not going to have as much heat coming off them. Okay, so you can turn it around, you can rearrange it. So it's YH. But you can actually have glucose, giving you the amount of heat that it'll generate if you feed it to your cells is 0.4 grams per kilocalorie. Malate, 0.3 grams per kilocalorie, and so on. So how oxidized the substrate is changes how much heat is released per gram of cells that are generated. Okay, we want to now take that, that's very useful, and figure out our total amount of heat generation. Because we need to figure out, you know, how much cooling water we need to send through our cooling jacket to keep our lid on our cells so they don't turn to ash. So total rate of heat generation in a batch fermentation, we're going to call QTR. So total rate of heat evolution in a batch fermentation is the volume of the liquid times, we're going to call it mu net. Because in a batch fermentation, you have some death rate as well that starts moving into it. Just times x and 1 over yh. Okay. So that can be useful. Even more useful, there's a rule of thumb. And this is actually based on basic biochemistry. You could actually probably do the, like, how much heat is evolved per biochemical reaction in a loop. But the amount of heat generated in a batch reaction is about a tenth of how much oxygen is used up. So that's millimoles. So again, you want to make sure that you've got good reactor design. There are cooling coils that get used, but you do have to be really careful with how you sterilize them. Any questions? Okay, so I'm going to spend the last 5 minutes of the class just introducing you to what we're going to talk about next class, which is an introduction to some of the actual modeling of cell growth and growth kinetics. And there are different kinds of models that you can use. So how do you think you've got cells and you've got them growing? Do you think that every single cell in a bioreactor, got it in a batch reaction, you've got it in a CSTR, it doesn't matter. Do you think every single cell is doing the same thing at the same time as every single other cell? Are they all synchronized? They're all metabolically the same? They're all acting the same? No, usually there's a population of some that are off doing this, and there's another population that are off doing that, and another population that are off doing this. So if you were to do a cell by cell by cell analysis, they're actually all doing slightly different stuff. You can average them out, but they're all probably doing slightly different stuff. So if you wanted to be really, really careful about it, you could check cell by cell. So not really very easy to do them, right? Like if you're running a giant bioreactor or a fermenting tank, are you gonna go in and measure like what each yeast cell is doing? Probably not. So it's much easier to do your modeling by the population. It doesn't end up being all that useful. So there are a lot of times actually people now, for some things, will decide not to look at population kinetics or what's happening in the overall average population, and will look at it cell by cell. And that tends to be often actually with stem cells, because stem cells, they divide, sometimes they stay, you know, one of them will stay as a stem cell and one of them will differentiate. And what each of the cells is doing along the way actually can have a very big influence on what happens to the population at the end. So it's really important in things like that to understand what's happening to each individual cell. So that's where you see things like Monte Carlo simulations, where they look at huge amounts of data, and it's a probability that one event will occur at each time point. Okay, so it'll apply to, there's a probability you'll turn into this, there's a probability you'll turn into that. So it is actually not uncommon to see, so this is called segregated cell by cell, and that's unsegregated, is the population. Okay, a bunch of you have chosen papers that I gave you about synthetic biology. And in synthetic biology, are you looking at the cell as a big black box, or are you actually starting to look at some of the metabolic pathways and the organelles, which is what's happening within the cell very tightly? So you can actually look at what's happening within the cell. So we've got, stuff going in and stuff going out, but we have no idea what's happening inside the cell itself. Okay, so there are definitely people now who are starting to look both at cell by cell and structured patterns. It tends not to be done when you're looking at very large bioreactor situations. And there tend to be large unsegregated, unstructured models. And that's what we're going to mostly look at in this course. But what is, actually, maybe at the start of next class, we'll start talking about what are some of the benefits and problems of doing those, each of those modeling methods. Okay, any questions? All right, so next slide, in 3 short hours, we're going to start looking at how we actually model cell growth.